this video, we're going to start a new set of videos, that of pathology. In the first part of the set, we're going to focus on cellular adaptation, cell damage, and cell death. We're going to start precisely from adaptation, a very important process in the life of a cell. But before talking about adaptation, we'd better have a quick recap of the first cellular signaling pathways. So, in this video, we're going to have a quick look at the most common receptors of the biological world. Their transduction pathways, receptor after receptor, will be examined in depth later on. Now, let's start with a general outline of cellular adaptation. Cellular adaptation is a phenomenon that refers to some changes in its characteristics made by a cell to better resist in response to a damaged stimulus. By eliminating the damaging stimulus, this phenomenon is fully reversible. Cell damage is instead a more severe condition, occurring when the cellular adaptation can't contain the damage anymore, thus resulting in cell disruption. Cell damage instead can be reversible. This means that by eliminating the damaging stimulus, the cell may restore its initial status. After cellular adaptation, cell death may also occur. Finally, in the event of irreversible cell damage, cell death occurs, which is an irreversible process. Cellular adaptation, cell damage, and cell death will be examined in the next lessons, as shown in the outline. Let's start with today's topic, biosignaling. Each cell has some receptors on its surface allowing it to communicate with the outside world. This communication is given through molecules that are called ligands and that, by interacting with the receptors, stimulate the signal transduction. This simple mechanism is adjusted from receptor to receptor. In fact, each receptor has its own ligand and obviously its own signal transduction pathway. The first receptors that we're going to examine are those of the intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity. These receptors have an alpha external subunit and a cytoplasmatic tail with some particular characteristics. Their tail is in fact capable of phosphorylating. These receptors are incomplete on their own for an effective signal transduction, and they need to dimerize. When a receptor intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity binds its ligand, another identical receptor goes in search of the first one, and then the two of them dimerize each other. The ligand-induced conformational change makes the cytoplasmatic beta subunits, having the intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity, get closer and, therefore, phosphorylate each other. At this point, the beta-phosphorylase subunits are recognized by the adaptor proteins located in the cytoplasm, and they will carry the signal transduction downstream to the receptor. The ligands of this type of receptor are mainly a growth factor and therefore play an important role in cell growth and, as a consequence, in cancer development. An intrinsically connected pathway to the receptors of tyrosine kinase activity is certainly that of phosphatidylinositol 3 kinase, an enzyme that can bind the receptor of the intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity through an adapter molecule. Once the enzyme is bound to the receptor, the enzyme begins its enzymatic activity by phosphorylating the phosphatidylinositol, which is a membrane phospholipid. Phosphatidylinositol 3 phosphate at this point moves into the membrane and searches for other proteins to continue the transduction pathway. AKT, which is also known as protein kinase B, is certainly one of the most known proteins interacting with a second messenger that is a mediator in cell survival. Receptors of extrinsic tyrosine kinase activity differ from the previous receptors due to their inability of self-phosphorylating when binding the ligand. Instead, they go through a conformational change that will cause the kinase to phosphorylate them. Since the tyrosine kinase activity is given by external kinases that wouldn't normally bind the receptor, the activity is not intrinsic but extrinsic. Among the most known extrinsic kinases There is certainly JAK, which stands for Janus kinase. JAK phosphorylates a receptor, allowing its interaction with a transcription factor called STAT, that is to say, signal transducers of activated transcription. The role of STAT is that of activating itself after binding the phosphate and moving into the nucleus where it will stimulate the transcription of some given genes. Among the most representative receptors of the human body, there are undoubtedly the G-protein-coupled receptors. Having a complex structure, the G-protein-coupled receptors have 7 transmembrane domains, crossing the membrane 7 times. These 7 domains may bind in a different way to the site. Whatever the bond site is, the last domain usually presents a helix binding the G-protein. The G-proteins are heterotrimeric structures and they're made up of an alpha, a beta, and a gamma subunit. They are here is hidden. The alpha subunit is capable of exchanging the GDP with a GTP, a nucleotide that plays an important role in regulating these receptors. When the extracellular domain binds a ligand, the conformational change of the receptor stimulates the change provided by the alpha subunit between the GDP and the GTP. After this exchange, the alpha subunit binding the GTP protein will detach itself from the helix binding it to the receptor and will move along the membrane to keep on signaling. The beta subunit bound to the gamma subunit will do the same. There are different types of alpha subunits depending on their action. The alpha subunit can go search for an adenylate cyclase, an enzyme capable of transforming the ATP in CAMP, which will then be released. The adenylate cyclase is an extremely important messenger that can activate numerous proteins, such as the protein kinase A. The protein kinase C is another pathway that can surely be stimulated by the G-protein coupled receptors. The protein kinase C is really complex and polymorphic. In this pathway, the alpha subunit interacts with an enzyme called phospholipase C. The enzymatic action comes into play when the interaction with phospholipase C is an activator. As its name suggests, it in fact plays an important role in cutting out phospholipids. Phospholipase C is capable of mainly cutting the phosphatidylinositol that is then divided into two. The head, inositol 3-phosphate, and the tail, diacylglycerol, will then take two different directions. The head will reach a smooth endoplasmatic reticulum, where it will bind a channel receptor that opens to allow calcium ions to come out. The calcium ions will be then released into the cytoplasm. As we're going to see in a few lessons, increased levels of cytoplasmatic calcium have lots of effects. At the same time, the legs of the phospholipid, that is to say the diacylglycerol, reach a half-membrane-anchored enzyme, protein kinase C. This enzyme is involved in numerous effects ranging from metabolic exchanges to cell survival. Binding the diacylglycerol, the protein kinase C is only partially active. However, when bound to calcium, protein kinase C activity may increase several folds. There are also some less-known classes of receptors, among which we can find the receptors of intrinsic guanylyl-cyclase activity. The receptors of intrinsic guanylyl-cyclase activity are capable of converting the GTP in GMP. This conversion occurs inside the same receptor. So, as already said, since they are not so common, the ligands known for these receptors are few. Adrenal natriuretic peptide ANP is one of the ligands of these receptors. Similarly, the guanylin and the bacterial endotoxin bind this type of receptors. Nitric oxide, or NO, has this type of receptor as well. But since nitric oxide passes through the membrane easily, it is fully cytoplasmatic. So, these receptors cyclize the GDP and convert it into GMP, and then the GMP will have a number of effects and will become a second messenger, likewise, the CAMP. Finally, an extremely important receptor in cellular pathology is the trimeric receptor of the TNF family. A receptor that has a base of three identical but separated subunits and have an extracellular site of bond, an intermembrane and a cytoplasmatic part. In the cytoplasm, we can find a death domain since it triggers a number of effects, among which cell death. This receptor doesn't work on its own and the subunits do not have transduction skill. Its ligand is, however, trimeric, and for this reason, the three subunits have to get closer to each other when transducing through the adapter molecules. The adapter molecules may trigger numerous effects, such as the TNF-alpha inflammation, the main ligand of this family, or cell death through another ligand, like the FUS-L. But, as we're going to see later on, this family has dozens of receptors and therefore numerous effects. Thank you for watching. This video was created by School of Biomedical Sciences, Agora. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're curious or have any doubt or question, please feel free to leave a comment below. If you want to find out more about us or want to support our project, click on the following link to visit our website.